They come from miles away. It's always a giant crowd. Spring break in Florida. Time for racing, NHRA style. The Gator Nationals, for over four decades, has been a huge draw. Gainesville Raceway. Since 1970, it's been the home of the world-famous Gator Nationals, one of drag racing's majors. This race is big. A win here and you make history. It's time to make history again. A green light, uncast, nowhere to go on a one-track mind. So break down at the wrong time. I'm catching up, but I'll still be behind. Don't you just want to take a faster ride? Lower lows, higher highs. Get it going till you get it right. I hope you find it. Cause you just want to take a faster ride. Lower lows, higher highs. But you just gotta kiss me one more time. Kiss me Throttle Drag Racing Series is on the air from Gainesville, Florida. Top Fuel fires on the line. And look at the packed house that is here today. A giant crowd. There always is here in Gainesville. The Gator Nationals are huge. Steve Torrance and Morgan Lucas at the Tire Kingdom Gator Nationals. So much to report here today. We begin with Gary Gerald.
Already on this Gator Nationals weekend, one stunning off-track development with the disclosure yesterday that after nearly 15 years with John Force Racing, John Medlin leaving the Force camp. He's now taken up residence with Don Schumacher Racing. He'll work alongside Tommy DeLago as a co-crew chief on the funny car driven by Matt Hagen. And already it appears that the DeLago-Medlin combo is producing big results because in the final qualifying session yesterday, it was Hagen unseating Robert Height as the number one qualifier.
Thanks, G-Man. Bright sunshine here today. Tailwind going down the middle of the track, and we show you the Lucas Oil Top Fuel Ladder. Look at Corey McLenathan. He leads the points. He last won back-to-back races at the end of 2000. Well, Bobby Lagana won matchups over Massey, Antron Brown, Brandon Bernstein, and Morgan Lucas last year.
Other side of the ladder, David Grubnick up against Brandon Bernstein. Brandon's troubles continue as he does not have lane choice in that matchup with David.
First pair, always a little experimental. Nobody knows what this track is going to do when Nitro goes down. Steve Torrance lost to Lucas when they raced in the semis in Memphis in 09. Not today, though. Morgan Lucas finds his problem in the left lane at the line. Torrance runs a 387, 311-mile-an-hour pass, and takes a first-round win.
Morgan Lucas really struggled in qualifying and continued into the first round. Really only got down the track one time out of three in qualifying, but troubles right there. You saw it spun the tires really early on that run.
Oh, yeah, that's the noise that everybody loves. All right, so much other stuff going on. We'll go over to Dave Reif now.
Well, going to be a very, very busy day today, Paul, for Melanie Troxell. Not only will she be competing in her In-N-Out Burger Corvies, she's also competing in Funny Car, where for the second consecutive race, she will take on the other female in the class, Ashley Force Hood. It will be the third time the ladies have matched up in their career, each with one win. That means round number six Funny Car today will be the rubber match for the ladies. Let's check in with John Kernan.
It's been 2 weeks since the tragic accident at Phoenix involving Antron Brown's car that took the life of a spectator. Since then, there's been a lot of soul searching and a lot of hard work as the teams try to figure out a way to keep this type of tragedy from ever happening again. Today, Brown starts from the number one qualifying position. And while that may provide somewhat of a good feeling, they are still racing today with heavy hearts.
So here comes Doug Coletta and Doug Foley. Doug Coletta and Darrell Gwynn, Coors colors from 1990. It's a special weekend for Darrell Gwynn and the gang.
Oh, absolutely. 20th year since he got that win here in 1990. He was my boss, too, when I was driving for Darrell when I won here in 1999. It's definitely a special moment for me.
I didn't know you ever had a boss. That was interesting. They had this walk for charity track walk earlier. Look at that. And look at the crowd that came out for that.
Yeah, everybody donated to the Darrell Gwynn Foundation. It's a great foundation that provides wheelchairs and vans for physically handicapped people. Darrell Gwynn, after that tragic accident, after his win here in 1990, went over to England. He's been in the wheelchair ever since, but I can say one thing about Darrell Gwynn. He's never complained about the situation. He never looks at what he can't do. He's always looking at what he can do, and he's been doing a lot lately.
Right after that, he actually put out a couple of inspirational books, little sayings from a lot of celebrities, a lot of key people about how to fight and face adversity. Coletta and Foley.
Oh.
And again, the left lane is a problem. The right lane takes the win. Darrell Gwynn was hoping to see the car carrying his colors go down and find a wind light. It did not. A 395, 254-mile-an-hour pass for Foley takes the win. Connie's not happy with that one. Connie Coletta, the car owner.
Yeah, he's definitely trying to figure out what happened. Doug had lane choice. It looked like he might have just hiked the front end up, possibly hit the wheelie bar and unloaded. Your car, Doug Coletta, went to the first two finals of the season. He's not going to be doing that today here in Gainesville. Tough break.
And so we welcome you officially now to Gainesville and the Tire Kingdom Gator Nationals. I'm Paul Page with Mike Dunn. You know, I was down watching your NHRA Race Day show this morning, and there's such a buzz in the crowd at a big event like this. This one is very, very special. They call it one of the majors.
Oh, absolutely. And I can tell you, when I did get that win in 1999 with Darrell, it would have to rate probably in the top three of my 22 event wins. I mean, you know, and it was also had something to do with the fact that Darrell, you know, being Southern Florida native and getting that win for him and the team. But just to be able to say I won the Gator Nationals, I won the Winter Nationals, I won the finals, I won the U.S. Nationals. I never won a championship, but I was able to win the majors, so at least I was able to do something. But everybody comes down from the East Coast. The weather's always good. We had a lot of snow this winter, and they always look for great racing, and we've definitely seen a lot of great racing in qualifying up to this point.
It is the East Coast opener, and you couldn't have a better day for it. Maybe not the temperature that you would want if you were coming to Florida, but the blue sky, the bright sun, and for a racer, that temperature and the water grains looks pretty good.
Oh man, dry air, dry cool air doesn't get any better than that. When you factor that into the density altitude, where engines feel like they're only 900 feet above sea level, that is optimum horsepower making weather.
Well, Mike, you hit right on a track temperature of 81 degrees right now. Because of that cool dry air, these cars are making a lot of horsepower. And because of those cool temperatures, the track is very, very tight. So the key in the nitro categories for this first round, probably the second round, making sure you get enough wheel speed, but not too much. We could potentially see some tire smoke there. When it comes to pro stock, though, the atmosphere is about 500 to 600 feet better. I talked with a few crew chiefs. The national record could potentially come into play, especially here in the first round. We'll have to wait and see.
In top fuel thus far, we've had two pair down, two upsets. Now he's 54 years older than the guy in the other lane, Sean Langdon, and Langdon's moved into the right lane. Well, this time, once again, the left is a problem. Langdon chose correctly. A 391, 299 miles an hour, and a little fire.
Sean Langdon had a nice run early, big advantage off the starting line over the Greek. Obviously, the Greek then went into problems. But right there, you see the cylinder out on Sean's car early, and then it started eating itself up a little bit on that engine. You see the bad flame on the other end. That's why you saw a lot of smoke, probably some pretty good amount of piston damage on that particular run.
Coming up in Funny Ladies, as Ashley Force Hood once again squares off against Melanie Troxell for the second week. Back to Gainesville right after this.
ESPN's presentation of the Tire Kingdom NHRA Gator Nationals is brought to you by Full Throttle. Feel the energy at work. By Tire Kingdom, right now buy three tires and get one free. See store for details. And Copart, zillions of cars, bid now. Now Robert Heitz already begun to warm up back in the pits as he gets ready for his funny car matchup against Jim Head in just a few minutes. Jimmy Prock looking over that big motor, produces 8,000 horsepower. These guys and these long skinny ones also go $8,000 on the power. Dave Grubnick and Brandon Bernstein. Brandon Bernstein lost in first round at Phoenix racing David Grubnick. And Grubnick's last win on the tour came right here at the Gator National.
Because left lane does seem to be giving the teams a bit of a problem. David's teammate Doug Coletta took the left-hand lane and spun the tire. So Brandon Bernstein's got his work cut out because they struggled a little bit in qualifying, and they are not in the good lane right now.
Grubnick, on the other hand, ran a 3:21.5 in qualifying.
Oh, look at that.
Oh, and this time it goes over to the other side. Brandon Bernstein takes the win in the left lane with a 389, 313 miles an hour.
How about that? Nice job. First car to really go down that left-hand lane.
Grubnick had tied the fastest speed ever in 1,000 feet with that 321.5 in qualifying, but he couldn't turn it into a win.
Like David just flat overpowered that right when he hit the throttle. Kind of wash out a little bit, and I'm wondering, it didn't look like it hit the wheelie bar maybe as hard as Doug Coletta, but the end result anyway was Brandon Bernstein going to the second round.
And back at the line, Todd Payton and Antron Brown. Brown, the number one qualifier. Go back 2 weeks ago at Phoenix when Antron Brown got in trouble coming right off the line.
Had a cylinder out, went into some severe tire shake, and then lost the left rear wheel, sending the car careening into the wall. The wheel continued down and actually hit a female spectator, and unfortunately she died of her injuries.
And since that time, the NHRA has an investigation going. They also have an independent group coming in looking at it as well. And the teams themselves have already begun to look for fixes.
Well, and NHRA, you know, was founded on safety, and we're always looking at making things safer. But with an incident like that, everybody gets involved. Usually the crew chiefs are looking to make the cars go faster. But when something like that happens, a lot of times they'll put their expertise into it. And that's what we've seen. Jim Head, Ed McCullough, even the Colettas have come up with some different ideas. I like Head. It's kind of a retainment system if it does shock away. He's been involved with a number of these projects to try to make these cars safer, and they are going to come out with something better. It'll probably be out within probably a few races, I would imagine.
Now there's Dan Olsen. Todd Payton, you saw him, his first race of the season. Antron easily 397, 229 miles an hour. So the right lane has now produced a couple of wins for us. They figured it out, Mike.
Well, and Antron actually had a, you know, a decent run going. Something happened down track. It was probably after half track. Let's take another look at it. Had good numbers early, picked the front end about the way you want to. Not too high, not too low. Just gets that nice balance transfer. Then they were applying the clutch through the middle there, 277. Then you see it just broke the belt right there. As soon as that blower belt comes off, it's all over. But luckily, he had enough to get the win.
And Mike, we're down here in the staging lanes. Ashley Force Hood with a big matchup for the second week in a row against Melanie Troxell. And Ashley, it seems like you and Melanie just can't stay away from each other the last couple of races.
I know, it seems like her and I keep matching up, but I'm finally on the other side of the ladder from my relatives, Dad and Robert, who've taken me out the last two races in a row. So hopefully we can do well here in Gainesville today, go some rounds, and maybe get back in that winner's circle. I won here years ago in A-Fuel, so we're sure hoping we can do that again today.
She'd like to get a Wally today. She has lane choice as she faces off against Melanie in the first round of Funny Car Eliminations.
John Kernan, thank you. Terry McMillan and Tony Schumacher. Schumacher has won Gainesville here three different times. Let's take you back on Friday when young men and women here at the Gator Nationals had a chance to check out the Army's YES program, Youth and Educational Services. The program gives students real goals. Tony Schumacher and Jack Beckman each led teams through the program on Friday morning. Yeah, why weren't you out doing any of that, huh? Where were you, Mike? Weren't you supposed to be part of that?
I did 60 back in the TV compound. Just didn't see it.
Well, drop right now and give me 20, okay, will you?
Yeah.
Last time I heard that, I didn't like it. So there is Tony Schumacher through two races.
That's Don Schumacher racing, the entire team. Yeah, right. And what's really impressive, only one round loss with all the teams that got the two wins with Corey and Jack Beckman and a record of 22-10. That's pretty impressive.
Nice race, Tony Schumacher with the win. Terry McMillan did not embarrass himself at all. He runs a 386 to Schumacher's 381 at 320 miles an hour. That's a career best for McMillan.
Let's go on board with Terry. I mean, like you said, this was a good race. Tony had the advantage off the starting line a little quicker on the track, but like you said, Terry McMillan did a great job to just get that car down the racetrack. Take a look at the Sarge. He does this so well. I mean, this is why he is the champion. He's always just consistent on the lights, and like we saw, he always does the things for his sponsors. And you kids out there, if you want to drive a fuel funny car or top fuel dragster, it's not all about the driving. You got to be able to do the work for your sponsors, and nobody does it better than that man right there.
So Tony Schumacher hops out after a win. He will face Foley when they come back. And when funny cars come to the line, Matt Hagan, what a story he's become this weekend. Number one qualifier with John Medlin helping out. More from the Gator Nationals in just a minute. The NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series from Gainesville, Florida. Hi, how y'all doing? We welcome everybody here. Giant crowd here today. Look at that, the grandstand filled. Larry Dixon and Pat Dakin are coming up next, but we'll go to Gary Gerald.
Entron, there's obviously great satisfaction when you earn the number one qualifying spot. How does that satisfaction compare with the satisfaction of race day eliminations when you get the first round win?
Oh, that first round win, I'll take that over any day over number one qualifying. I mean, just get past that round. I mean, it's a lucky round. I mean, we're lucky that Todd and him had problems over there, but the car was running great all the way down the racetrack, and this gave us a little mishap, but we'll get her back, and I know Brian and Mark and the boys are going to get back on this car, and we're going to put those Mackle tools to work, and we're going to get it back together. So I'm looking forward. You got a big smile on my face for this next round, and we're just going to go out and see what we can do. You know what I mean? It's got a lot of heartfelt, and we got a lot of passion out here, so we're going to keep on driving, Gary.
Thank you.
Dixon and Dakin. Dixon takes the win, 382, 319 miles an hour. Pat Dakin, 395. He first raced here. Dakin did 1973. Of course, Larry Dixon is the defending champion.
1973, I was still in high school, and I'm old.
I didn't even know you were born then.
Man, I'll tell you, that's a nice pass by Larry Dixon and Alan Abbey team. 382, second only to Schumacher's 381.
And sets him up to face Brandon Bernstein. The NASCAR Nationwide Series is heading off to Bristol for some short track racing. Coverage begins on Saturday at 2 Eastern on ABC with NASCAR Countdown presented by Hellman's. Had Kurt Busch in here yesterday. He's actually racing here in Supergas this weekend. Corey McLenathan and Bobby Logano Jr. Let's go to John Kernan.
Matt Hagan, number one qualifier in funny cars, taking on John Smith in the first round of eliminations and getting a little extra help this weekend from John Medlin, helping out Tommy DeLago. He's now joined the team. How much input did John have this weekend?
You know, I think definitely John's putting his thoughts in there and really looking at the computer. But right now, I think he's feeling his way through it. There's a lot to learn. I'm sure we do a lot of things a little bit differently than what he's used to. So right now, I think he's another set of eyes, which we can definitely use. We're glad to have him on this diehard car, and I think that we're going to see a lot of good things to come from this man.
Thank you very much, and best of luck.
Thank you so much.
Corey McLenathan, the points leader. A little bio blast, Mike.
Well, five top fuel drivers to sweep the Western Swing. He's got 32 career wins, won this.
19 races last season to win his first event. This year it took only two.
Corey on the race day set this morning, I asked him, I said, is this the best car you've ever had? He's had some good ones, and he said, yep, by far. His chance to get his first full throttle championship.
Oh, wouldn't that be great to see it this Corey's year? Final here last year. He lost to Corey. Well, it's Corey Mack, but again, we're seeing some good side-by-side. 381, 322 miles an hour to a losing 395. That 322, say you, is that good? Yeah, fastest speed ever.
Wow, and he was going 282 miles an hour at the eighth, and that thing, I can guarantee you, if you went 282 miles per hour at the eighth mile, and then 322 miles an hour at the finish line, just 1,000 feet from the start, that, I tell you, that engine never laid down.
So obviously, Corey has a horse under him for this weekend. Will it be back-to-back wins for him? Well, let's look now ahead to the second round in Top Fuel as we look down the list with Corey McLenathan going to face Sean Langdon. That's going to be huge.
Other side, Shu and Foley, and then look at that matchup. Larry Dixon and Brandon Bernstein. That brings back memories.
Car, John Force's car already coming in from the staging lanes, and a little bit later it will be the ladies, Ashley Force Hood, and she comes up against Melanie Troxell. Yeah, they're gonna go against one another here at the Gator Nationals. Melanie actually got a ride on the East Coast. We didn't expect that, but it's good. NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series Tire Kingdom Gator Nationals from Gainesville Raceway. I'm Paul Page. Mike Dunn's alongside in the booth looking over the track. Gary Gerald, Dave Reef, John Kernan, they're all here as we're in number three of 23 this year in 2 weeks. Let's talk about funny car. John Force and Bob Bodie are on the line as we take a look at the Lucas Oil Funny Car Ladder with Ashley Force Hood and Melanie Troxell coming up. That's a rematch of round one at Phoenix that was won by Force.
Matchup I'm looking on the other side of the ladder, Bob Tasca. He's their defending Gator Nationals champion. Up against our most recent winner from Phoenix, Jack Beckman.
Well, do you need more John Force? You're not getting enough. To hear him discuss current world events and his 25th anniversary with Castrol, you can go to ESPN.com for Force of Nature or just listen now.
We just kept building a better product, and you give somebody 150%, you get it back. And they've taken care of me for 25 years. My own wife wouldn't put up with me for 25 years.
That's not the benchmark I think I'd be looking for, though. Would you, Mike?
No.
Here comes John Force and Bob Bodie. Bob Bodie's in trouble right away. John Force going to get another round win.
That was a nice run by John because he struggled a little bit in qualifying, even though he's your number six qualifier. Went down the track two out of three runs. Remember, we got rained out the first session on Friday, so cut it back from four to three. If you take a look at it, John's car went over there and drifted over towards the wall just a little bit. He did bring it back over right there. See, it's kind of out of the groove. Then he brings it back around. Still runs a 408, 310. Best numbers for him this weekend.
Here come the brothers, the Pendragon brothers. Tony Pendragon and Cruz Pendragon coming to the line now. Let's go to Dave Reef. He has Melanie Troxell.
Melanie Troxell readies herself for funny car competition. Remember, she's still driving that Pro Mod car today, too. Busy, busy day, but God, does it get to be any funner than this?
Hey, this is a great problem to have. You know, I get to drive two race cars, and they're both running good, so I'm having a lot of fun.
Your thought about the rubber match with Ashley?
Boy, you know, ran her last week, and we didn't get the win that time, so I think it's our turn this week.
Here we go.
So with Tony Pendragon and Cruz coming up on the line, let's take a look at how they pair up as brothers in competition.
Very impressive. Probably the most successful brother teams we have in drag racing. Tony has the edge, though, 43 to 26 wins. They both have two titles. And then in head-to-head matchup, Tony definitely has the edge there, 24 to 12.
And Tony ran a 3:11.49 for a speed in qualifying, his 1,000-foot best. There's Cruz. One win here at the Gator Nationals, 98 over fourth.
That run, Tony gets a lane choice, and as we've been seeing, everybody's pretty much taking the right-hand lane. There's Kenny Koretsky, Captain Chaos, who's helping Tony Petrogon out this season with sponsorship. And right now, Tony just wants to get this past his brother. Hope we get a Gator Nationals victory as we see Johnny West walk away. The car he's now tuning.
Lane is problems, and that means that Tony Petrogon gets down with a 4:12, 310 mile an hour pass. Donnie West gets to write it down and say we've got another win.
Well, coming up next, we're going to hear or see Ron Capps and Dell Worsham, and we're going to hear from a man who I believe has his swagger back.
I'm coming back.
The name is Force.
Boy, you're getting drama now.
Being up on the starting line, it's unbelievable. I mean, they're so loud and they're so powerful.
If you're not ready, it'll put you on the ground.
I think you're in the middle of the noisiest earthquake in the world.
My vision still blurs, and I have a hard time focusing on a nitro car when it leaves the line, besides the fact my eyes are burning from the nitro.
Well, I want to remind you about some upcoming NBA action, and it's a good doubleheader. How about the Detroit Pistons? They've had their struggles this year, but so have the Boston Celtics. But the Lakers keep rolling in the West. They've got the Golden State Warriors. Steph Curry, Rookie of the Year candidate, chasing Tyreek Evans. Well, we've got John Force standing by here at the top end. I don't know how much he knows about NBA basketball, but I know he knows a lot about NHRA drag racing. And I pose the question, does John Force have the swagger back?
Just like Kobe Bryant.
Yeah, if he, you name dropper.
If he's drinking full throttle, he'll be okay. And he puts Castle in his hot rod. But you know, Kobe knows the drill. I know the drill. Some days you're up, some days you're down. Right now, I got a good Mustang out there. I'm excited because I got three of them, Auto Club and Ashley out there with Castle. So right now, we're just trying to focus. I'm excited that I can play with the kids. You know what I mean? I'm out here with a hot rod. The fans, you know, I've been down. I stunk last year. Actually, the year before, too. But the fans... Even the racers are glad. Thank you. Still kicking.
Thank you, John.
Okay. The baby up.
I'm impressed you knew who Kobe Bryant was. I figured you would say it was a Japanese steakhouse.
Oh, no. Oh, that's going on the list. Ron Capps and Dell Worsham.
Wow.
How about Capps 407, 310 to a losing 415 for Dell Worsham.
Eddie Ace McCullough is doing a great job over in that Napa car. He seems to always do it at the beginning of the season. Delaware has been struggling a little bit, starting to bring it around, but unfortunately he was up against this man right here, Ron Capps, 407, 310 miles per hour, a career best speed for Ron, and they're in the second round.
Yeah, and where they will face John Force. And so Ron Capps, who was pretty good here in the 52nd annual March meet.
It was a Nostalgia Funny Car race, a 32-car field. He made the quickest Nostalgia Funny Car pass at a 5:67. He did get beat in the second round, but they had a number of cars there, including that man right there, Cruz Petrogon, driving the Joe Paisano tribute car, and also our Gary Dinch, who went to the final round in his Nostalgia Funny Car.
Good time at Bakersfield. Wow, that's always fun to watch. And now, as Matt Hagan and John Smith come out, let's go to the stat guy.
Smith qualified for his only funny car race last year at Richmond. He happened to be on the bump spot. He took out the number one qualifier, Jack Beckman, who happens to be the teammate for Matt Hagan.
So Hagen and John Smith. Matt Hagen, third time from number one in his career. He ran a 3:13.5 in second fastest speed ever. Needs to go 3:10.44 to back up the run for a record.
Hey, in the condition, Matt's teammate Ron Capps right in front of him in that lane, so they know there's going to be no excuses as long as they hit that tune-up and nothing, you know, goes wrong. Obviously, with a car that produces 8,000 horsepower, there's so many little things that can happen that can mess up a run. But right now, they seem to have a pretty good handle on that race car.
So, crew chief there is John Medlin. He obviously has already had a little bit of impact. There he is on the line. Looking for a 3:10.44 on the speed off of Hagen.
John Smith in the other lane with his dad, Paul Smith. Paul Smith's nobody better than usually getting a race car down a tricky racetrack. He just brings a car out a few times a year and usually does very well. He's not going to be your number one qualifier, but usually he'll get the car in the show, and most of the time the thing will go from A to B.
Yeah, John raced his only career final round here in 2003, then losing to Brandon Bernstein. Hagen, 3:16. Look at that. You talk about backing it up.
You talk about some speed.
Wow, he actually went too fast. That's some big numbers. Dave Reif.
Let's start with Tommy DeLago. And Tommy, you've had a great car already. The addition, though, of John Medlin, how do you think that can help this race team?
It can help. Anytime you can add brain power, you can make your team better, and he's just so easy to work with. Even already, it's been such a smooth transition to have him come right in. It hasn't disrupted us at all.
4:06, solid job.
Thank you.
Going down this track, too.
Yeah, well, we had it yesterday, and he went 3:13, and then went 3:16 today. I mean, it's still a fast run.
Ron Camps, Hagen, talk away. 2 weeks from today, we'll be four wide at the inaugural four wide nationals in Charlotte. Qualifying on Saturday at 7 o'clock. Then NHRA race day presented by Lucas Oil as they try to count all the way up to four. Dave Reif and my buddy Mike Dunn on the set. And then the finals, that's going to be at 5 o'clock on Sunday. And down at the far end, Ron Capps was right there to congratulate Matt Hagen on that 3:16.5. He already had the backup for it, so there you go with a new record number. Here's Jim Head, and Robert Height will be in the other lane. Wins by lanes, Mike, in the Nitro cars.
Right lane's the lane of choice, and you see 11-1. That's the reason why, but left lane's definitely come around since the first couple pair of top fuel cars, though.
Robert Height has not been treated well here at this track. No finals, only one round here, win in the last 3 years. Yeah, but let's just add another one in, a 4:12 at 305 miles an hour to a losing 4:22. Robert Height's happy, John Force is happy. That's a good thing. Well, coming up, we've been talking about it throughout the morning. It's going to be the ladies. Ashley Force Hood and Melanie Troxell are coming to the line. They've done it before. They're going to do it again. Who's going to win it this time? At the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series Tire Kingdom Gator Nationals, here are the ladies. That's Melanie Troxell in the other lane, the Indy champion Ashley Force Hood. Well, Melanie Troxell, she's also running, you heard it earlier, the ProMod Series this weekend. She also does bobsled. The fifth annual Lucas Oil Jeff Bodine Bobsled Challenge in January 10th. Jed Coughlin was there, Melanie, Morgan Lucas, Sean Langdon, and Joey Logano. But Melanie Troxell took the gold among the NHRA drivers. Mike, we ought to go do that, huh?
Yeah, we need to. But I'll tell you, I'm impressed with Melanie doing, and she goes out there and wins the thing. I mean, she's just, you know, she's a natural.
Have you ever done that?
No, I haven't.
It's scary. It's scary, man. NHRA female winners, and we've got in this list two of them right on the line, Troxel and Ashley.
The active drivers highlighted, Melanie's got five wins, Ashley has three.
And as long as they have Karen Stolper up there, she's a story too this weekend. Boy, she seems to be back in fine form. You'll see her when Pro Stock Motorcycle comes out. Let's see where it's going. Melanie Troxel gets very close to the wall, but it looks like Melanie Troxel is a first over the line of 5:30, 258 miles an hour in a pedal fest against Ashley Forrest Hood.
Man.
I thought she had the wall.
There were some sideways race cars on that run. Take another look at it. Melanie, a slight advantage off of the starting line. Looked like they pretty much spun the tires about the same time. Ashley might have been a little bit sooner, but she spun them harder. Watch this again. Cars leave a slight advantage to Melanie. Ashley spun the tires just a little bit sooner there and then smoked the tires harder. But look how, wow, look how sideways Ashley got. Shoot, Ashley, her parachute actually went and got the block. Now let's see if Melanie touched the wall. I don't think she did, but she got awfully close down there.
Oh, man.
Yeah, it was
hard
close.
Hard to tell.
I don't think so, but taking a look at Ashley. Now, right here, it's going to go out there and spins the tires. She gets out of it and then gets back on it, and then it blows the tires off and she stays in the throttle just trying to leg it down through there, and then the car starts rotating around, and boy, right there it gets big time sideways. Gets the chute, it shoots out though, and straightens that car out. Just look how close on the left side of the screen right there.
Let's go and see if
that
there's any
close
paint on that wall. That's going to be the answer. Boy, both of them were just, did you see? Well, of course you did. You were looking at the TV, how far Ashley Forrest Hood got. Gary.
Camera taking a look at the side of the car here. We see no visible damage whatsoever.
All
but
right.
Melanie Troxel, you had more than your hands full. When you talk about you doing double duty in pro mods, that car looked like a pro mod the way it was skating that time. How close a save?
Pretty close to the wall there, had to lift, obviously. Never really thought I'd touch the wall, but that's as close as they get. That's kind of crazy. Boy, you know, that's not the way you want to win the round, but I got her all crossed up close to the wall, and I thought, wow, she's not there. I got to get back in it and see if I can get to the finish line. So, hey, this is just exactly what this team needed. We've come out here. We're looking for primary sponsorship so we can keep running races. We've got In-N-Out Burger, Redline Oil, some great companies that are helping us do this, but we needed a round win so that we can keep this deal going.
All right, thanks.
Oh, and we tell you, it's going to be a great pair. Do we come through or what? Here comes Bob Tasca and our latest funny car winner, Jack Beckman, now second in the points. Tasca won his first career race here last year over his friend, Tony Pedregon. Gary Gerald now has Ashley Forrest Hood.
Well, we heard from you a bit earlier about how you continue to get matchups early in the season against Melanie, and that time she had her hands full with a dramatic save. You also had your hands full. What was the problem there for your car?
Well, I just kept trying to recover it, and it didn't want to recover. I lifted off, I stepped back, launched. So, you know, I did the best I could. I, at this point, don't know what I would have done any differently. I just couldn't get it down there, and she was able to recover hers quicker. So, we're frustrated, we're bummed. My brother-in-law and dad are still in, so my job now is to root on them.
Thanks.
Yeah, she was around almost 90 degrees. I mean, she was looking at the left side wall for a minute.
Yeah, and she did actually, the first pedal drop, she caught it pretty quick, but then when she got back on, it smoked the tires really hard, and then that allowed the car to rotate around and cost her the win.
And Bob Tasca, we told you about his win last year from his first career pole for Jack Beckman. Now, this is his fourth race here at the Gator Nationals, but only one round win in that time. Now put that one down for Tasca as Beckman finds his problems. A 4:13, 308 mile an hour pass for Tasca. And that's a career best speed, 308 miles an hour. Bob Tasca will now face Robert Height when they come back into the quarterfinals.
Yeah, mild upset here. You know, your defending Gator Nationals champion takes out your most recent winner, Jack Beckman, who didn't have lane choice and was in that left-hand lane. Bob Tasca didn't have any problems getting down that right lane, and as a result of that, he's into the second round.
Well, as we continue to look at this, Melanie Troxel and Ashley Forrest Hood, both of them find themselves in that pedal fest, and Melanie Troxell comes out on top. But look how far Ashley Forsthood got the car around. The engines fire at Gainesville Raceway for Tim Wilkerson and Jeff Arend, and it's time for Sounds of the Strip.
But, you know, he's had our number here the last couple of races. But Ford and Dodge, Ford came out on top of Motorcraft Quick Lane, Ford Drive 1. You got to go four rounds to defend Mike.
Trouble early. Tim Wilkerson, a 4-8 of this season. Tim Wilkerson will now face Matt Hagan when they go to the quarterfinals for Funny Car. That's our last pair in Funny Car.
Take a look at Jeff Arend. Like all the other two Coletta Top Fuel dragsters, similar results. Spun the tires pretty much at the hit of the throttle. You see Tim Wilkerson racetrack for the fourth run in a row with that new Mustang.
And the ladder now going to the second round. Matt Hagan, Tim Wilkerson, Tony Pedregon, and Melanie Troxell. Both of those are good matchups.
Other side, you got Height and Bob Tasca going at it, but how about Ron Capps and John Force? Ron Capps will have lane choice by virtue of that 407 over John's 408.
Well, let's go to John Kernan. He has a Copart Fix-It Pit Report.
And, Paul, just a tad bit of concern in Antron Brown's pit. For the second day in a row, they broke a push rod, and so they have decided better safe than sorry. They pulled the old engine out, put a brand-new engine in it. Yesterday, it broke at about 850 feet when they ran 321 miles an hour. Antron says they should have ran about 323 miles an hour. He faces Steve Torrance in the second round.
All right, so let's get you caught up on what's going on in pro stock. Here is the ladder with Mike Edwards. Can that express train take down Ricky Jones? Ricky doesn't want it to happen.
On the side of the ladder, I'm looking at an upset alert. I'm looking for Bob Yonke to possibly take out Jed Coughlin. Bob coming off that runner-up finish yesterday from the Phoenix race to Mike Edwards.
And at the line, ready to go in pro stock, Vinny DeSigley and Ronnie Humphrey. Little matchup, but take a look at Ronnie Humphrey, a 655 to 11 takes the win light.
Next up, it's Greg Stanfield and Jason Lyne. Greg Stanfield goes red. He knew he had to push the tree against Jason Lyne. Jason Lyne takes her on down to a 655 at 211 miles per hour for the win.
Happy birthday to that man, Greg Anderson, 49 years old today. He goes up against Steve Spieth. Anderson has the hole shot, and it pays off. Anderson takes the win on the hole shot, 660, 210 miles an hour.
To go on board with Greg Anderson, he definitely had the advantage off the starting line, but the car did not leave well. You saw it there, just shook, hit the shift light. But luckily, that starting line advantage that he had off the start over Steve Spies gave him the win.
And there is the Motel 6, who got the light with Greg Anderson's win.
Next up, we got V Gaines and Roger Brodgen. Two cars have been running pretty well this weekend, but this time it was V Gaines as Roger Brodgen had some problems. V takes it to a very nice run, a 6:55 at 210 miles per hour to advance him into the next round.
The Mopar, Alan Johnson and Shane Gray. This is Alan Johnson all the way. He runs it down 6:58, 210 miles an hour to a losing 6:61.
Next up, we got Mike Edwards and Ricky Jones. Can anybody stop Mike Edwards? Ricky has 0.02 of a second advantage off the starting line. Will it be enough? No. A 6:52 at over 212 miles per hour. A monster run for Mike Edwards.
Mike Edwards also makes power for Ron Crisher as he faces Johnny Gray. How about Crisher? 6:54 to elude.
And our final pair is our E3 Plugs upset alert. Bob Yonke over Jed Coughlin. Bob's been driving great, getting whole shot wins yesterday. But they left pretty much dead even, but both cars made great passes, but it was Jed Coughlin just getting the win with a 6:55 at 211 miles per hour.
And let's take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam, Mike. Close, pro stock.
Jed Coughlin over Bob Yonke by just a nose.
And so now let's take a look at the ladders. Looking ahead, Mike Edwards and Ronnie Humphrey will face one another. Alan Johnson has to take on V Gaines.
Other side of the ladder, you're going to have Ron Crisher and Jason Lyon. A big matchup there. Jed Coughlin and Greg Anderson, and Jed will have the lane choice.
And when Nitro comes back, Top Fuel, it will be Sean Langdon as he gets ready to face Corey McLenathan. They faced one another in Charlotte last year in the final. Corey won that one. We'll see who can do it this time. Second round of Top Fuel at the Tire Kingdom Gator Nationals, part of the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. Antron Brown and Steve Torrance. But first, let's get you caught up on Pro Stock Motorcycle.
First up, we're going to have Sean Gannon, Junior Pippen. Sean Gannon on the right side of your screen. Junior was number 8 qualified, number 9 for Sean Gannon. But this was going to be Sean Gannon, a good race. A 6:89 takes out a 6:94.
And then Steve Johnson and Matt Smith. New motorcycle, new operation, Allanabi for Smith. But it's Steve Johnson that takes the win. 6:97, 193 miles an hour.
Next up, Craig Treble and Michael Phillips. This was all over at the start. It's over 193 miles per hour for the win.
L.E. Tonglin and the champion, Pro Stock Motorcycle, Hector Arana. A 005 light for Hector. Look at him. He's gone. Easy win. 6:86 at 194 miles an hour.
Next up, David Hope and Mike Berry. Mike Berry has problems before he gets off the line. David Hope takes it on down there to a 6:93 at 189 miles per hour.
Eddie Krawick comes up against now Angie Smith. You knew her as Angie McBride. Doesn't matter. It's Eddie Krawick that's going to take the win here. Eddie Krawick runs a 6:86 to a losing 6:97.
Next up is Riddell Harris up against your number one qualifier, Karen Stover. Riddell gets the advantage off the starting line, but watch Karen fly on that Suzuki. 6:84.7, the quickest elapsed time ever at over 193 miles per hour.
And you can bet that Karen Stover, when she realized she had those numbers, how fired up she was. Oh, yeah, Karen Stover. You know she's got to feel good. She's taken a couple of schools to try to get her reaction time better. Yeah, oh, yeah. There's a little party.
right.
And we take you back to the starting line. Jim Underall and Andrew Hines, red light right away. That gives it away to Andrew Hines. Andrew takes it down with a 687, 195 mile an hour pass. So the Pro Stock Motorcycle Ladder in their first appearance this year looks this way. Karen Stopher will face Sean Gann. And Hector is going to have to take on Andrew Hines.
Other side of the ladder, Eddie Krawick and Steve Johnson, Harley versus Suzuki, and David Hope against Craig Treble on another Suzuki. Craig will have the lane choice in that matchup.
That sets you up on Pro Stock Motorcycle. Here is Top Fuel, Antron Brown and Steve Torrens coming to the line in just a few minutes. Sean Langdon and Corey McLenathan, both hard chargers.
Other side of the ladder, Tony Schumacher and Doug Foley, and Larry Dixon and Brandon Bernstein. Larry going to have the lane choice in that matchup.
But right now, Antron Brown closest to you. He beat Steve Torrens in round one at Pomona. Gary Gerald.
And Paul, talking with Dexter Tuttle before this round, he says they're not doing anything fancy here, just going A to B, trying to run an 84-80.
Not a bad run against a guy like Brown, but it's a 381 to a losing 386 for Torrens. Antron Brown advances.
Antron Brown and the team, because they didn't have lane choice when the first round win. They lost the blower belt down track when the supercharger backfired. Came back without lane choice. That left-hand lane, though, makes a very nice run to get them into the semifinals.
And when we come back, two former winners at this track will face one another. Larry Dixon and Brandon Bernstein from Florida. ESPN's presentation of the Tire Kingdom NHRA Gator Nationals. Brought to you by Choice Hotels. When you stay two separate times, you can earn a free night. For details, visit choicehotels.com. Well, there's Larry Dixon and Brandon Bernstein. Larry Dixon, the defending champion here. Let's send you to Gary Gerald.
Karen Stopher savoring what appears to be a national record. You already have the backup. You've been working so hard on the offseason. When you get rewarded this way, does it exceed your expectations?
No. I mean, I knew yesterday. I called it yesterday. I thought the conditions were going to be the same. We still have a strong tailwind. The track's prepped good. So I knew that we could get this Geico bike down. It does so well in the wind, and it does so well in good conditions. So I'm so proud of the team putting it all together. I'm glad I was comfortable on the tree again. I'm really liking my new riding style, especially when we put records down like that. So to Geico Power Sports, to all my family in Virginia Beach, to our mechanics, wear gloves, ARP, and everybody, thanks for sticking.
Has ever gone quicker on one of these bikes.
Nice job.
That is very cool. So two former race champions here, as Brandon Bernstein won this event in his rookie season over John Smith. Brandon has his problems. It's going to be Larry Dixon, a 383 at 317 miles an hour.
As we look at the tire tracks from Brandon, it looked like he shook the tires pretty much as soon as he hit the throttle, and then went up into tire smoke. Larry Dixon's got a pretty consistent race car out there, 382s, 383s every time it pretty much goes down that racetrack.
And next Saturday, the NASCAR Nationwide Series is going to head off to Bristol. Coverage beginning at 2 o'clock on ABC with the NASCAR Countdown presented by Hellman's. Kevin Harvick won this race last year. Now John Force, he climbs into his machine. Next up for him, it will be Ron Capps as they go to the quarterfinals. And how about that John Medlin story? Let's continue looking at that. Dave Reif.
Team as they prepare for round number two with a 316. Tommy had a great handle on this car coming in. Have you actually been able to massage anything on his combination so far?
Not really. I just happen to be the guy that sat in the chair that's sitting next to a pot of gold. That's all I can tell you. Tom and these guys do an outstanding job. The motor was very happy in the finish line. They got a great combination here, and I think there's a tremendous amount of potential here.
How good do you feel to be back over and involved in a tune-up again?
I think the best way to describe it would just be thrilled.
Well, there's Doug Foley's first race of the season. Try this on, Mike. He's 2-1 career over the seven-time champion Tony Schumacher.
Wow, I never would have guessed that. That is impressive indeed. But Tony Schumacher, they're awfully tough based on that first-round run. Tony's always just pretty steady on the tree, and Mike Green gives him a car that goes down the racetrack the majority of the time.
And you don't want to make Tony mad at you. He may just do that to you. 383, 319 as Doug Foley finds his problems right at the start.
Just a standard old Tony Schumacher run. Nice reaction time. He had 700, so almost 700 of a second on Doug Foley, and then he never looked back. 383 in the heat. I'm sure that's probably about the number they were looking for. You don't want to go push it too hard. Look like a cylinder might have went out just before the finish line, but still nice job.
And on the line, Sean Langdon and Corey McLenathan, the fastest driver at 1,000 foot, 322.5. Sean Langdon is in his second season in Top Fuel, still looking for his first win. Let's learn more about this California native.
Hi, I'm Sean Langdon, driver of the Lucas Oil Top Fuel Dragster. I started racing in 1994 when I was 12 years old in junior dragsters and moved up to Super Comp, Alcohol Dragster, and now into Top Fuel Dragster. The way I get focused for a run is usually when I'm in a tow vehicle, I'll listen to John Scherzer. He gets me all dressed up, gets all my equipment on, then I walk around to all my guys, give them all knuckles, get them all in the same on the same page, and get them all ready to go. Best advice I ever received was treat people how you want to be treated. That's something my mom always taught me as a kid, and that's something that you can really apply in drag racing. My best racing memory so far here in Top Fuel was definitely my first final round in Charlotte. Racing Corey McLenathan, someone I grew up idolizing, and being in the final round, something I always remember. But my best race moment, you know, definitely would have to be winning the Supercomp Championships back-to-back in 2007 and 2008. You know, the best thing about being a drag racer is, you know, I really can't think of one.
Not bad, Sean.
That's what I miss about driving. I knew there was something.
Well, guess what? He was the runner-up to Corey Mack at Charlotte. He mentioned that. His only final round last year, and now he faces Corey again.
And Sean Langdon's one of the best on the reaction time. I mean, he really can't hit that tree. Corey McLenathan knows it. Now, Corey, when he has a good car underneath him, he can usually just step up and rise the occasion. But he knows Sean's the best in the business. He's hoping he can just kind of keep him in within range. And Corey knows that he's got a race car that can get the job done. When they came out the first session on Friday, Corey did and shook the tires. They said that's the first time it's done it all year. And since then, he's went 383, 383, and 381.
Gator's one of the few races that Corey Mack has not won. That's a good one.
Wow.
How about that? Sean Langdon, 385, 317 miles an hour. The hole shot does it for him. He takes down Corey Mack.
Well, we talked about that kid being quick on the lights, and he definitely is. An 046 reaction time. Now, Corey was not late. Corey had a good light, 062. Can't be ashamed about that, but that Sean Langdon kid is just brutal on the tree. And then he runs a 385. Corey's car fell off just a little bit to a 384. It wasn't quite enough to get the win, but good job by Sean Langdon and that team.
And the 317.5 is a career best speed for Langdon. Look at that Lucas Oil photo finish. What is that, Mike? A foot and a half?
That's close, Paul.
Yeah, close. There you go. I love that precision kind of stuff.
Well, I get the big bucks.
You do, man. So, how are they going to match up when they come back for the semifinals? Antron Brown's going to have the lane choice as he faces Sean Langdon.
Another matchup, Tony Schumacher and Larry Dixon. The rivalry continues, and this time Larry Dixon's going to have the lane choice.
Well, coming up, it's going to be Funny Car. John Force, winningest man in Funny Car here at the Gators. And he will take on Ron Capps. Should be a terrific matchup as Funny Car comes to the line in Gainesville. 'Cause you just wanna take a faster ride. back in Gainesville, Gainesville Raceway for the Tire Kingdom Gator Nationals. It's all part of the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. Here's Tony Pedregon and Melanie Troxell as we take a look at the funny car ladder. We'll see Matt Hagan and Tim Wilkerson coming up, and right now we're going to see Tony and Melanie.
Other side, Robert Height and Bob Tasca, and then the big matchup, Ron Capps and John Forbes, with Ron having the lane choice. Right now on the line, though, I don't think lane choice is as big a deal as it was possibly in the first round. Funny car didn't seem to be anyway. We just saw Sean Langdon and Corey Mackel right down the racetrack. That's good news for Melanie Troxell. We remember against Ashley, she did not go down that racetrack, so I'm sure crew chief Lance Larson is going to back her down and make sure it goes A to B.
Well, Tony Pedregon, 4.11, 310 to a losing 4.16 for Melanie Troxell in her 200th round of racing in Nitro. Tony Pedregon gets down there with a 310.2 as a speed. He ran a 3.11.49 in qualifying. That was his 1,000-foot best.
It looks like they're getting the consistency back in that Nitro Fish funny car. Johnny West is usually a master getting a consistent race car. And you saw Melanie, they did slow down a little bit. I'm sure that's exactly what Lance Larson wanted to do. Let's just get it down the racetrack and see what happened. But unfortunately, he came up a little bit short to that man.
Hey, at the top end, Gary Gerald. Sean Langdon feel pretty good about himself?
Well, no question. Tell us what the adrenaline rush is like, especially when you get a whole shot victory against the guy who's leading the point standings.
That's huge. That's probably one of the biggest rounds that we've had this year, maybe even in my career in top fuel race, and running a guy like Corey McClance, especially this year, you know, first in points. He's been a thorn in my side since I started. I love that guy to death, man. He's been a great mentor of mine, helped me out a bunch, and it's just good to, you know, get a win for this Lucas Oil, Map TV, Speedco. I mean, all these companies help us out, and, you know, Toyota, everybody, man. It's just, it's good to be able to help out and contribute to the team.
See Sean against Antron Brown in the semifinals.
And that's going to be good. Right now, it's John Force and Ron Capps. And, of course, John Force leads the point. He won at Pomona over Capps and was runner-up at Phoenix. Last time he started a season with back-to-back finals was 2002. He's moving up on a round win. 2009. Through two races, nothing. He's got seven now.
I'd say that's a pretty good improvement.
That's an improvement.
But this is a monster matchup right here. I mean, both of these cars are running very well. Two very good drivers. As we mentioned, Ron Capps, lane choice by virtue of that 407 to a 408 in the first round. You know, it's going to be one of those things. John Force, you know, he had very good lights the first couple of races. He was kind of a little bit off here when he's in the first round, but, you know, he's always been able to step up when he knows he has a hot rod underneath him, and both these drivers have good hot rods under them.
Boy, no kidding there, but Capps is the winner, 406-312. Ashley Forsood looks on and I'm real happy with what her father came up with there. He loses to Ron Capps.
I'll tell you, that was a great run by Ron Capps, though.
Let's go to Dave Reif. He's got Ed the Ace.
Ace walking away with a look of satisfaction on his face. I know it's just a second round race. Don't want to make too much out of this, but with John Forrest kind of having that swagger back, how satisfying was that round win?
Well, anytime you beat John Force, whether he's up or down, is, you know, it's big. We've just been working really hard to get our consistency back. Tommy D's doing a hell of a job with the diehard car. And, you know, our whole team is pulled together and everybody's doing a good job.
Career best speed for Ron and you guys. Congratulations. Ron Capps, a two-time winner here at the Gators.
One more look at you saw for John had a slight advantage off the starting line, but then it just did not pull through the middle. And because of that, you take a look at our Lucas Oil photo finish game. It was Ron capped by just over a car length.
So at the line, it will be Tim Wilkerson and Matt Hagan. That 312.3, as Dave Reif told you, for Capps was his career best. See that flag? That's the reason why. They've got a tailwind, and it's going right down the middle of the drag strip. Gary Gerald now has Ron Capps.
Ron, we just heard Ace, your crew chief, talking about what it's like when you line up against John Force and the satisfaction when you beat him. From Ace's standpoint, how about from the driver's standpoint today?
Especially the way they're running this year, we owed him from Pomona. He rolled it in deep on me and made me look foolish in Pomona, and so I took a little off there. It's probably an 04, 05. Great run by Ace. Napa Gold, Filters, Freightliner, all the guys on the car. But I don't care if it's rolling the rental car back to the hotel, man. You want to beat Forrest no matter what you can do. And that was big. We're just trying to go around. But great communication with Tommy DeLago, all the crew chiefs and Ace. And it's showing right now. That's big speed for Ace. And he's an ET kind of guy. But I tell you, I don't get interviewed unless I either beat one of the Forrests or I'm standing next to him. So I guess we just got to beat him for now on, huh?
Savor the moment, lad.
Thanks, man.
Okay, then. Well, Tim Wilkerson and Matt Hagan.
There's an upset.
Oh, yeah, baby. Wilkerson with that new Ford body on the car. First time he's had it this year. Takes down the number one qualifier, Matt Hagan. Runs a 4.09 to do it.
Well, I tell you, Wilkerson's got to be loving that new car. It's also a new chassis and new body. Take a look at Matt Hagan. Let's see if we can tell what happened right there. Goes in tire shake. He back pedals it. When he did it, put a cylinder out. That slowed him down big time. And I'll tell you, Tim Wilkerson, he's been going down the racetrack every time he hits the throttle, and he keeps getting a little quicker and a little quicker. You're going to have to watch out for him.
ESPN is your NBA destination on Monday night, first at 8 o'clock. The Pistons head to Boston to face the Celtics, and then at 10:30, Kobe Bryant and the Lakers travel upstate to take on the Golden State Warriors. The NBA special edition on ESPN and ESPN360.com Monday night. Back at Antron Brown's pit, they are hard at work. Looks like the whole motor is coming out of that car. Next up for Antron will be Sean Langdon. Yeah, look at that. Blocking everything right out of the car.
Pulling an engine out. And that's kind of routine. I mean, it might have spun a bearing on a crankshaft or something. They ran it pretty hard, and they'll just take one out and put another one in. Usually it's no big deal.
They got them
guys stacked
up there don't they? Yeah. All over the place.
They usually have at least 8 engines together ready to go, because normally you make 8 runs on a weekend if you win the race.
And what a piece.
A lot.
Like a whole lot.
Yeah.
Robert Height and Bob Tasca. We'll get back to you with the facts on that one. That guy's looking. Bob Tasca, track wear in 2007. He ran the quickest top alcohol funny car pass in history. Now he comes up against the quickest man at any dip. And Robert Height's in trouble. Tasca's going to take the win. Seeing some interesting runs now, Mike.
Yeah, twice in a row in that right-hand lane. It's got them in the middle of the racetrack.
And for Tasca.
Be 4 lanes.
He's already looking ahead. I'm out of this one. I'm just look ahead. For Tasca, that run at 309.7, his fastest run ever.
Watch Robert Height, left side of your screen. Now, he went farther than Matt Hagan. That was during that clutch application. It started spinning the tires. I don't think he had much tire shake before that thing went to basically blew the tires right off.
Now we know what it's going to look like in the semifinals. It's going to be Tim Wilkerson with the lane choice as he faces Tony Pedregon.
Other matchup, you're going to have Bob Tasca going up against Ron Capps. And Ron, by virtue of that great 4.06 laps time, will have the lane choice.
Pro Stock's coming up now, so we'll show you the ladder for Pro Stock with Mike Edwards and Ronnie Humphrey. How do you beat Edwards? Good luck, Ronnie. And Alan Johnson and V Gaines.
Other side, we got Ron Krischer and Jason Lyon, and a big matchup on the line right now. Jed Coughlin and Greg Anderson, and Jed is with the lane choice, is taking the right lane, which everybody in Pro Stock has done up to this point.
And we've got a little update from the stat guy.
Two of the best in Pro Stock between the two, 108 wins, 7 championships, but Greg leads head-to-head 34-23. This is Pro Stock at its finest.
And for got here by virtue of winning on a hole shot over Steve Spies in the first round. Made a terrible run. The car just spun and shook in low gear. They're going to have that fixed right now to be able to get around Jed Coughlin, because Jed's been making some very good runs this weekend.
Dead even off the line, but Coughlin's in trouble. How about Gregory? Is he on his way to a win?
Yeah, he might be. I think he might have got a little bit of a break there. Jag, like I said, he's been making some good runs. If you go on board and take a look at right side of your screen, watch that tire shake. Look at that. See how violent that was with Jack, and he had the wheel cranked over. It was pretty much done shortly after he let out the clutch, and Greg Anderson makes a nice run, gets that fist pump at the other end because he knows he's going to the semifinals.
You got to love that double onboard camera thing. That is so cool. Let's go to Gary Gerald. He has Tim Wilkerson.
For the first time, Tim Wilkerson, you've got that new Mustang body. I know you front half this car, the chassis. Did you dream it might come out of the blocks this effective?
Oh, yeah. This has been a good car. It was a good car when my kid drove it last year when the wheels fell off, and it's still a good car. My new 010 Shelby Mustang, it's showing off a little bit this weekend. Tell you what, the diehard car, top of the class this weekend, right? No doubt about it. We're lucky to get by those guys. Glad to see diehard in our sport. We need them people. Today's Levi Rand Shop's turn. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Well, you look on board with Alan Johnson, was the runner-up here last year on a hole shot. He will go against V Gaines. V ran a career best in round one. Looks like that program may actually be working. Baby on board. Is that referring to V himself?
He's no baby. He's been around for a while.
That baby look, though. Come on.
Yeah, you know. But, yeah, he's done. They've done a great job. I mean, that 6:55 in the first round was a very nice run by V. And if he can continue to do that, he definitely has a shot. And that 6:55 gave him a lane choice also.
Hey, and Paul, V. Gaines says that this is a four-door, after all. That's why you got the baby on board sign back there.
All right.
So if you drive a four-door, you got to have a baby.
You got to have a baby, sure.
Allen with a big advantage.
And he carries it on down. Alan Johnson's 660 to a losing 661 for V. Gaines. Alan Johnson at 210 miles an hour.
On board with Alan, 300ths of a second advantage off the starting line, going through the gears. Definitely not the run they were looking for. Only a 660 elapsed time. He was 1 second flat in 60 foot. So I'm sure he spun the tires a little bit. As you take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam, by just under a car length, Alan Johnson gets the nod.
Well, back in the pits right now, Tony Schumacher is doing what he does second best, signing autographs. Can you imagine how many he has signed? Tony Schumacher will face Larry Dixon, that ongoing rivalry, when we come back with Top Fuel. It's the Gator Nationals, part of the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. From Gainesville Raceway, the Tire Kingdom, Gator Nationals, one of the majors in this sport. Time for the Geico Power Sports Tractionary, Mike Dunn.
Well, after the problems we saw in Pro Stock in Phoenix, the NHRA came up with a few rules. So the Tractionary this week is splitter.
And there it is.
It's attached to the bottom of the front bumper, and it is designed to separate the air to go over and under the car, creating more downforce on the nose of those, make it more drivable.
Part of the whole aero package and some changes to that on Pro Stock in the past couple of weeks. Jason Line and Ron Krischer.
Big advantage for Jason.
And it gives him a win. Jason Line, 658, 210 miles an hour. Ron Krischer, a 659. So that set Jason Line up to face his teammate, Greg Anderson, in the semis. Well, let's go to John Kernan. He has Corey McLenathan.
Well, Corey, your day comes to an end early. How disappointing is it when you know you have a great car and you get beat on a hole shot? Still, not a bad lie at an 062.
Any way you look at it, you know, hole shot loss, a hole shot loss, and I, for one, just, you know, won't stand for it. It just is very disappointing to me. Have a good race car like this and have these guys work this hard, I need to be there for them. And when Todd says, I need you, I need to be there. And I know it was very close. Sean's a great driver. We had a great race. It was just one of those things where anybody else probably would have won. But it's one of those things where I need to go back to the drawing board. I need to try harder next time. And that's what happens here at DSR. There is no way to do this except for a win. And that's what we're here for.
And they'll be at Charlotte looking to win at four wide in a couple of weeks.
Well, this is Ronnie Humphrey's chance to take a shot at Mike Edwards, the Phoenix winner in his 22nd career win there. At this event in 97, he was a runner-up to Jim Yates. But can Ronnie get it done?
I think he's definitely going to have to get the whole shot advantage off the starting line. He's 3/100 of a second behind, 3 to 4/100 of a second consistently from Mike Edwards. Of course, pretty much everybody is, you know. So obviously, you got to go up there. These drivers are going to have to try to push the tree a little bit. Mike, on the other hand, we've talked about all the time, he's got to go out there and have good lights. You know, you don't want to push the tree and get red light, but you also don't want to be too relaxed and be late, because pro stock competition, you know, you're still 3 or 4 hundredths of a second's a lot in pro stock time, but in real time, that's not a whole lot.
Even you cannot do that against Edwards. 6:54, 210 miles an hour, and Mike Edwards marches on. He'll face Alan Johnson. So we'll give it to you officially now, the semifinal matchups. We'll see lane choice going to Mike Edwards when he faces Alan Johnson.
Now the pair is going to be the teammates, Jason Line and Greg Anderson. And Jason, by just a little bit, is going to have the lane choice over Greg.
And Tony Schumacher's pit, they continue to work on his car while Tony starts to think about his matchup coming up against Larry Dixon. That has become a classic. Alan Abi and the Army. There's Dixon. Can he take down the Army car and Tony Schumacher? We'll find out in just a few minutes. Moment this morning at the Gator Nationals for the Darryl Gwynn Foundation, Mike.
People were able to donate to the foundation for a track walk with a replica of the car that won here in 1990, the 20th anniversary of Darryl's last win here before his accident in England that cut his career short.
And take a look at that giant crowd. They had the old team together, and there is Darryl Gwynn, little wheelchair giveaway for the weekend, and Dave Reif had a chance to talk with Darryl.
Talk about inspirational. Darryl Gwynn said in his book he only had one bad day. That's how inspirational this 18-time national event winner, tied with Shirley Muldowney and Brandon Bernstein. That a great body of work from 20 years ago. Since then, though, your body of work is impeccable.
Well, I appreciate that, Dave. You know, this isn't a club I signed up for, but just trying to take advantage of my situation and help others. And today and this weekend, we had a great weekend for the Darryl Gwynn Foundation. We kind of hit a home run. We've covered all the bases here. You know, we got awareness, we raised money, we had a track walk. A lot of great things for the foundation today.
What do you think about that Coors Extra Gold car? 20 years flashing back, remembering.
It looked awful good, and I have to thank Connie Coletta, what a great guy for doing something like that. I can't ever remember in the history of the sport where another competitor commemorated somebody else like that. You know, that was just that's just really cool to me, and thanks to the Coletta guys for doing that.
Does it feel like 20 years since you were in that winner's circle?
Well, you know, all I have is great memories from the Gator Nationals, so really, you know, as long as I'm in Gainesville, I'm in the winner's circle.
Dirk, unbelievable. Thank you, Darryl, for all that you do.
The NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series on the line. Craig Treble and David Hope. Pro Stock Motorcycle red light right away, and that never works for you.
I'll get you the loss every time, and Craig Treble on the Suzuki does not make a very good run. 7:03, probably dodged a little bit of a bullet right there.
So the red light goes on for David Hope. Craig Treble on the new DSR Suzuki, tuned by Steve Tartaglia.
Look at that thing. That thing wanted to make a move right over towards the wall. I mean, this was about as bad as you can get, but look at Craig Treble hanging on to that mount. Wow.
Let's go to the far end, Gary Gerald and Jason Line.
Jason, your next competition, your teammate Greg Anderson.
How do you spoil his birthday, as if I didn't know?
Well, I'm going to do the best I can. The good news is one of these summit cars is going to be in the final. And, you know, we're struggling a little bit right now with the racetrack and just our setup in general. But, and, you know, Mike's making us all look bad. But we're working on it, and we'll definitely get there. There's no question about it. We got a great team behind us, and we're going to do the best we can. But I want to say a shout out to a friend of mine, Tanglefoot Charlie, a guy I used to drive cab for back in the day. He's from down here in Florida, and Charlie's got cancer, and he's a great guy and taught me a lot. So I just want to say hi to him.
Thanks, Jason.
Thank you.
Tanglefoot, pretty cool. I wish I had a nickname like that.
Well, the ladder for Pro Stock Motorcycle. Let's give you a look at that, even though we are underway here. Hector Arana and Andrew Hines coming up, and Karen Stopher and Sean Gann. Karen is having a great week.
The other side, we've already seen Craig Treble advance. The other matchup is going to be Eddie Krawick on the Harley up against Steve Johnson on the Suzuki.
Well, Hector, of course, is the defending champ here and the 2009 Pro Stock Motorcycle champion. This is the first appearance of Pro Stock Motorcycle this year.
And all the other professional categories, pretty much everybody with lane choice has been going in the right-hand lane. Pro Stock Motorcycle's been a little bit different. We saw some teams take the left-hand lane with lane choice, including Andrew Hines. And I got to believe that Hector Arana having lane choice, he might have said, hey, you know, if Andrew likes that left-hand lane better and it looks pretty good to us, you know, let's put him in the right-hand lane and we'll take the left. They do things like that from time to time.
Well, they got a different deal, you know, two versus four wheels. You got really four different lanes out there.
That's true. Oh, Andrew goes red by 9,000ths.
Wow. You don't see that very often. So that's going to belong to Hector just based on the red light alone. He runs a 691.
Oh, and Andrew threw away a 689.
Oh. By 009. Hey, it's short track racing. The NASCAR Nationwide Series is heading to Bristol next Saturday, 2 o'clock on ABC with NASCAR Countdown presented by Hellman's. And it's time for a Copart Fix-It Pit Report, and my man Mike Dunn.
Well, it looks like they're putting that engine back together, and it seems like they just ran a little bit ago. It doesn't take these guys long, does it? They just put the supercharger manifold on. They're working on wheelie bars, mounting the wheelie bars on a wheelie bar on the back of that car. The clutch guy probably just ahead of that is putting the clutch in, finishing touches on that, hooking up the linkage, and getting ready for that big matchup with the shoe.
Don't get that kind of service at Shorty's Garage. Eddie Krawick and Steve Johnson. Steve Johnson with a new helmet. And it doesn't help him on the lights. We got another red light. An 033 red for Steve Johnson. Wow. A 685.6 for Eddie Krawick at 194 miles an hour. Career best for Eddie. And at the far end, Gary Gerald has Hector Arana.
Hector, as the defending champion coming into a brand new season, do you experience or feel more pressure than you have in the past?
Oh, no, definitely. I feel more pressure. You know, I know that the guys done a lot of work over the winter. They're coming after me. The Suzuki got six more cubic inches, which is at least 18 to 20 more horsepower. I did a lot of PR, a lot of interviews that I really didn't have the opportunity and chance to work on my engine development. I just hired a guy, so he's rookie. He's green, total green. So, the pressure is on, but nothing we can do. I know I got a good motor over here, this Lucas Oil bike. She's running great, and we just got to find our tune-up. We'll be all right.
Thanks, Hector.
Karen Stopher. You've got one of the new motors. They're having a little trouble producing cranks to get the new motors out this year, but she's got one of them. It helped her go to a new record.
Well, and that's how they're getting the extra cubic inches. 100 cc's, about 6 cubic inches. They can't go any wider. To get cubic inches, you either have to increase the cylinder size or the bore size or increase the stroke, and that's how far the crankshaft turns and pushes that rod and piston up in the cylinder. So they're doing it with the crankshaft, and it takes a little while to get those crankshafts made.
He goes up against Sean Gann. Coster, record notwithstanding, Sean Gann, 694 to a losing 697 for Karen Stopher. Wow, that's a surprise.
Take a look at this, 106 and 60 foot, but the problem was right there. It went out of the groove and was spinning the tires too much, even though it's carrying the front end, and then she's got to hang off to the left of that thing. Probably caused her maybe to miss the shift points just a little bit. You just add all those things together, slows the bikes way down. Just a tough break for that Geico machine because it's been run so well all weekend.
And so when Pro Stock Motorcycle reappears for the semifinals, Hector will face Sean Lane Choice.
At the matchup, we're going to see Eddie Krawick on the Harley up against Craig Treble on that Suzuki, and Eddie will have the lane choice.
And how about the semifinals in Top Fuel? One major matchup, Tony Schumacher. He faces Larry Dixon. Doesn't get much better than that. Bet you this one's going to be good, too. She's a little
We welcome you back to Gainesville. A look at Larry Dixon's pit as they get ready for a major matchup in the semifinals here at the Gator Nationals against their longtime rival, Tony Schumacher. This is a Napa track fact. And Tony, the last time you and Larry squared off against each other was Pomona in the semifinals. Beat you on a hole shot. You guys ran identical ETs and identical speeds. So is it now payback time?
Well, it's always payback time. But he's been leaving with 40 lights. He's doing something pretty special this year. He's got a great race car. And he's driving like a champion. So it's our job to stop him. We got to go out there and do what we know how to do, go out and win this race and try to take a points lead.
So you're going
to
beat him?
I'm going to do my best, man, no doubt about it. We're going to make sure when we're done we left nothing on the table. That's all we can do every time.
Thank you very much, Tony.
Well, ESPN is your NBA destination on Monday night. First at 8 o'clock, the Pistons head to Boston to face the Celtics. Pistons are battling to stay out of the cellar in the Central. And then at 10:30, Kobe Bryant and the Lakers travel upstate to take on the Golden State Warriors. The NBA special edition on ESPN and ESPN360.com Monday night. Well, Tim Wilkerson, these crew chiefs and drivers, they know a lot about how to make these cars run at the racetrack. Now Tim Wilkerson shows us what he's learned on his funny car that can help your car run better on the street. Please do try this at home.
And as a crew chief, I can tell you that a lot of times we believe that's overinflation of the tire. We do a lot of tire pressure differences based on track conditions, and that kind of helps our car go up and down the racetrack. A lot of times you'll come into my repair shop in Springfield, Illinois, get your oil changed. You'll leave thinking, wow, something's happened to my car. Now actually it rides different than it used to. And you'll come back and tell me, Tim, what did you do to my car? And I say, listen, you came into the shop, your tires were underinflated. Now we've actually put them to the correct inflation, which is gonna do a lot for your vehicle. Fuel mileage, make your car handle better. But it does give you a little rougher ride because now you don't have that nice squishy tire going down the road. First tip for you, keep your tires inflated, makes your car handle better, everything about your car will be better.
And Tim Wilkerson is going to face Tony Pendergon when he comes back. Larry Dixon's getting ready for a big matchup. You know who he faces? Yeah, Tony Schumacher. The conflict continues in Gainesville. At Gainesville, early this morning, the category is Super Gas. The driver is Kurt Busch.
Steel Challenger, Kurt Busch, making over 1,100 horsepower, running in that Super Gas category.
And we caught up with him earlier.
Me and my buddy, about 2 years ago, bought this car, started working on it. And we bought it just as a muscle car, and it started taking on different identities. So we got a turbo on it. It's got a Power Glide transmission, four-link rear suspension. We went full-tilt drag racing, so here we are to have some fun. We started with 15 grand, bought it off eBay. We bought it just for the look that it had, and then we started to gut it, threw all the parts away, because we knew we were going to make a race car with it. And it just, one thing led to the next. I don't know how much money's into it. I have yet to add up the receipts. But my guys, a bunch of good volunteer guys, and then my crew chief, Jesse Walker, he's been with me the last 15 years in all of my racing adventures, and he's a drag racer at heart, so I trust him 100%. I think this car's got a 7-second pass in it once we get it underway.
Tony Schumacher and Larry Dixon are getting ready to meet in Gainesville. The last time they met was in Pomona. Wow. Are these guys close? Will it be close when they come to the line? And so here comes Tony Schumacher. Here comes Larry Dixon. And, of course, Larry Dixon won that run at Pomona by a hole shot after identical ETs and speeds. Let's show you the ladder as we get ready to go here in the semifinals. Schumacher and Dixon, that's on the line now. Antoine Brown, John Langdon, they'll begin up shortly. Those are both great matchups for you.
Boy, we've talked about this rivalry, and it's been getting just better and better. It seems like every time these two drivers and cars come to the line, Tony Schumacher's, you know, obviously talks about being a machine, and he is always very consistent. But Larry Dixon really stepped up his game this season. You heard Tony even allude to that fact in his interview. Then he's been
like, that's exactly what Jason McCullough, Larry Dixon's crew chief, was telling me. He says they have all the confidence in the world, Larry, because with these top fuel cars running as close as they are right now, you're going to see some whole shot wins. Jason says they're going to try and pick it up right here just a little bit to run an 81 or an 82. Says it should be a good race.
Oh, you bet it should be. The weather has been perfect throughout the day. Still have some light winds. They're now crossing the track a little. Shouldn't affect the run. Schumacher, Dixon, here we go. Look at it. Are these guys well matched or what? 24.98 miles an hour for Schumacher. Wow, that is by far the fastest ever.
Boy, look at that speed. It is nothing short of exciting. Tony Schumacher had the advantage off of this starting line by not quite 0.02 seconds. A little bit quicker on the racetrack, but boy, that big speed, almost 300, and car was flying at the finish.
Take a look at the intervals as they went down the track. Schumacher, 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 and then that enormous speed.
Amazing.
Yeah, Don Schumacher, the dad and team owner. Nice and happy about that one. G-Man?
Boy, Tony, every time you and Dixon go side by side down the racetrack, it's hold your breath. I mean, what a great drag race. Here's the congratulations. You both run 82s. The speed, however, 324, almost 325. Were you expecting numbers like that?
Well, you know, I think I actually were. I'm not sure the mile per hour, but we tested down here. We tested in Florida. We tested in conditions that were very, very similar to this. And Mike Green says we're going to run faster than they expect us to run right now. Hold on. It's going to be a great job for the U.S. Army, Matco Tools, Gates Belts. More importantly, for my beautiful family, for the soldiers, for their beautiful families. Them guys are overseas doing their job. Families back at home. That one's for you guys. We love you.
Thanks, Tony.
Now back to the line. Sean Langdon. And the guy closest to you, Antoine Brown. Antoine's looking to race in his first final round of the season. Langdon, if he can do it, his second career final round as a pro.
Interesting to note that Antoine with lane choice has taken that left-hand lane. I don't think it's a bad move. The lanes look very even. That's obviously what we saw just the pair ahead of them. And the other fact is that Antoine didn't have lane choice in the previous round, and he went low ET of eliminations with a 381, so he decided, hey, let's keep her in that left-hand lane.
And throughout the day, the weather has been just fine. Look at that. Air temperature at 71 degrees. Track temperature only up to 98.
Yeah, and it's kind of holding right there. Very manageable, and that's why we're seeing some great runs.
And it's dry. Well, look at that.
Wow,
Antoine Brown, a 380 at 318 miles an hour. Langdon gets down with a 390, 304. Dave Reif, you've got Brian Carotti.
Brian, it will be you and Tony Schumacher, the all-Don Schumacher final. After everything that happened in Phoenix, describe what it means to come back and have the success you guys have enjoyed so far this weekend.
What it means. Well, it means that we as a team, you know, are performing the best of our ability. And, you know, what happened in Phoenix was out of our control. And we're making up for it.
Absolutely you are.
Well, that 380 elapsed time, that was low ET of the meet. That's just a great job that entire Matco team are doing right now.
Well, as we show you the top fuel final, one way or another, Don Schumacher wins this. Both entries out of his team. Antoine Brown will have the lane choice over Tony Schumacher. One more look at that run. Wow, what some great racing here at the Gator Nationals.
Track conditions are perfect right now, and this is going to be a great final between Antoine and Tony Schumacher. I can't wait.
And already in the water box, the funny cars are coming to the line. Tim Wilkerson, Tony Pedregon, Bob Tasca, and Ron Katz coming up. We are back. The Tire Kingdom Gator Nationals, Gainesville Raceway in Florida, part of the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. Tim Wilkerson and Tony Pedregon ready to get going in funny car. Little recap, round one, Ashley Forsgood and Melanie Troxell. And you give this one to Melanie. As Ashley Forsgood gets in trouble, so does Melanie. And very close to the wall for both, but it's Troxell that dominates.
And then Melanie tried to rebound in round number two up against Tony Pedregon. She got down the racetrack this time, but unfortunately it wasn't quick enough as Tony Pedregon was able to get the win with that 4:11 lap time at 310 miles per hour.
Also in the second round, John Force and Ron Capps with Ashley Forsgood already out. Now John Force is gone and Robert gone. So there they are, Wilkerson, left side of your screen, Tony Pedregon looking for his 76th career final round. We'll show you the ladder. First this group, Wilkerson and Pedregon
up here on the starting line too, because Tim Wilkerson really seems to be getting a handle on this new race car. You heard said it was the car that Daniel crashed in Memphis. I'm sure they put a front half on the chassis, so it's like a brand new frame. Yep, and then the new body, and it's been working very well. Seems to keep out running a little quicker and a little quicker. But Tony Pedregon in the other lane's been pretty much doing the same thing. Johnny West, one of those guys, just likes to kind of whittle away at it a little bit at a time. And right now the track conditions are great. I mean, I think they both can step them up just a little bit more from what they've been running. And it should hold.
And Mike, you're talking about Johnny West. Well, Tony Pedregon told me his new crew chief is now in the comfort zone, and he can tell it because that performance is picking up. They're going to step it up right here because they think there's a little more out there on this racetrack.
I think that's a good call, but I definitely agree there's a little bit more on the racetrack. But sometimes it's a fine line from just going a little bit too far.
Tim Wilkerson, Tony Pedregon. Tony Pedregon's done. Here goes Wilkerson into the final. He last won at Sonoma last summer. He's into the finals here at the Gator Nationals.
Well, we talked about Tony Pedregon just going a little too far. It almost looked like it might have hit the wheelie bar. Remember, they have the wheelie bars on. Sometimes they use it to just kind of hit that wheelie bar and let it just get it up on the tire to get the tire speed. But if it hits too hard, then it takes the weight off the rear tires, and then it's just going to spin right at the head of the throttle. Could have possibly have been what happened to Tony Pedregon on that run.
When Top Fuel comes back for their final, it'll be Tony Schumacher and Antron Brown, Gary Gerald.
You've got Schumacher in the finals. You've got lane choice. What's it going to take to walk out of here with a Gator National Wally for the first time?
I tell you what, I mean, that run there in the middle of the day like we did at 80 was pretty strong. So Brian and Mark and the rest of our boys got this car on point, man. So just going to go out there and just do the same thing that we just did. Just go out there and hit it hard as best we can. But I tell you what, it's going to take 324 miles an hour. So that U.S. Army team is no joke right here, right now. We have to go out there and steal all their macro tools so they can't work on their car. That's how we're going to get done, Gary. But seriously, we're just going to go back, work hard, and it's going to be a great drag race. Flip a corner, you don't know who's going to win, so it's going to be a great race.
Can't wait.
ESPN, your NBA destination on Monday night. First at 8 o'clock, the Pistons head to Boston to face the Celtics. Celtics cruising through the Atlantic Division. Then at 10:30, Kobe Bryant and the Lakers head upstate to take on the Golden State Warriors. All of that's just part of the NBA special edition on ESPN and ESPN360.com on Monday night. Ron Capps and Bob Tasca. Tasca defending champion here. Capps looking for a 61st career final round in funny car.
And guys, remember, first round of eliminations, that left lane became a little suspect. And read on what was actually going on in the left lane, with one exception, perhaps a little extra rubber as compared to the right lane. And what that did, Mike Dunn, is it made that racetrack a little spongy. So when the guys are going up there with all that extra horsepower from the cool conditions, the racetrack just wouldn't hold it. It didn't peel the racetrack up, but it was just a little spongy. They've since, of course, got that rubber off of there, thinned it out, and you can see it's coming around pretty nicely right now.
Yeah, Yeah, I think it hasn't, even though, Ed McCullough took the left-hand lane. Tony spun the tires ahead of him. But I also think possibly it could have been because the track was just so good to hit that wheelie bar and unload it.
That guy. It's amazing how Ed McCullough rises to the top in one of the majors like he does in Indy. He's won here at Gainesville four times, including back in 1972 over Larry Arnold. The guy is just, he's so good at the majors.
And the A's tells Ron Kapp, we're ready to go. You see the stat there, five times this man won last year. Still looking for that championship. Bob Tasca.
Oh,
and Caps is in trouble. Tasca is going to the finals again. Back-to-back finals at the Gator Nationals for the Tasca men. Remember, these guys are part of what they call an alliance, teammates, as it were, between Wilkerson and Tasca.
Yeah, Don Schumacher a little bit disappointed. Probably a little bit surprised, because I am a little bit surprised. Got the starting line very well to the 330 mark. It was pretty much hooked up, and right at that point, that's where it spun the tires, and then you saw them backpedal, Ron Kapp's backpedal. But look at that. The crew for Bob Tasca going to the finals of the Gator Nationals for the second year in a row. They are pumped.
And so it will be the gentleman from Illinois taking on Bob Tasca. When we go to the bed, Don Schumacher, you got two cars in the top fuel final.
Oh,
here we
baby,
go.
What a run for speed.
Yeah, Tasca's always fired up. He's going to have lane choice over Tim Wilkerson. G-Man?
Baby, how was that? Huh?
All right, you tell me how it was. You said the front end was trying to point straight up in the air.
Man, I rolled in, hit the throttle. He got out the half track, and it pulled the wheels up in the air. I went left to right, and the grace car didn't go anywhere. It set the front end down. It trucked down through there for Motorcraft Quick Lane. Ford Drive One, you know, we lost my grandfather in January. And he's up, he's smiling on us right now. Say happy birthday to my son, Austin, 6 years old today. We're going to the final round.
One step away from back-to-back Gator National victories.
Yeah. Can you tell what that man might do when he's excited? Well, stuff like this. Yeah, I'm into the final. Bob Tasca, you always get something good out of him. The Gator Nationals, it's been a great weekend thus far. We expect more in the semifinals now in pro stock. So here's the ladder. When they come up, it's going to be Jason Line and Greg Anderson. They are the teammates. You see them down there at the bottom. And, of course, Mike Edwards and Alan Johnson. Alan Johnson's going to be the next one to try and stop Edwards.
Well, we're obviously going to have a KB racing car in the final round, but who will it be, Jason Line or Greg Anderson? They're both running pretty equal. This could easily be decided on the starting line.
Greg Anderson was the runner-up at Pomona to Mike Edwards. He'd like another shot at him. Line's the defending champ here.
Let the clutch out and something happened.
Just broke right just off the line. Line takes the win, 660, 210 miles an hour. Greg Anderson just going to have to coast down the track.
Let's see if we can tell what happened here. Watch the rear wheels there. I couldn't tell. I couldn't see a whole lot of tire shake, but let's see if we can listen in one more time.
Sounded expensive.
It might just spun the tire so hard they didn't go in the tire shake, or it might have broke something. So they'll go back and look at it. But whatever it was, it cost them the round win.
And so with that, Jason Line is going to his 44th career final round. Don't forget, next Saturday, it's the NASCAR Nationwide Series. They're heading to Bristol, Tennessee for some short track racing. NASCAR Nationwide coverage begins Saturday at 2 o'clock on ABC with NASCAR Countdown presented by Hellman.
I'm tuning in because we had Kurt Busch in here yesterday, and he was talking about driving in Bristol and how this drag racing thing is kind of helping him out on them pit stops. I thought that was cool.
Interesting graphic to show you here. Here's Pro Stock, guys who won the first two races, Jim Yates and Jeggy, 96 and 2000. They went on to win a championship. What's that say about Mike Edwards? If I were to bet right now,
the only thing that I think can stop him is the countdown.
Yeah, that's true. When they reset those points, that really evens things up. So here is Edwards and Alan Johnson. Roy Johnson looking over Alan's car as they prepare to take on the powerhouse that is Mike Edwards.
You know, Mike Edwards, he's just going to keep doing the same thing he's been doing. Just go up there and try to hit any racks time in the 030 range and just let that horsepower take over. Alan Johnson, he's going to try and push tree, get a good light. They probably made some changes on that thing to really try to try something different. And a lot of times when you do that, that's when things happen. But
we've said it before, we'll say it again. You cannot come off the line even with Mike Edwards. 656, 211 miles an hour, and 032 reaction time for both. That doesn't work if Edwards is the car sitting next to you.
I tell you, I mean, 032, that's the same reaction time that Mike Edwards had in the previous round. He was 044 in the first round. That's all he needs to do all day because he's pretty much outrun everybody by about 300ths of a second.
So there's the matchup for the final in Pro Stock at the Tire Kingdom Gator Nationals. Mike Edwards, lane choice, we've seen this before, and Jason Lyne. We take you back up to the starting line. Pro Stock Motorcycle. You see those bright colors like that, you know. You're looking at Sean Gann now, looking at Hector, the 2009 Pro Stock Motorcycle Champion. Already Tim Wilkerson's pit, they're working away. They've got a matchup coming in the final against Bob Paska. Gainesville Raceway in Florida, the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. Tire Kingdom Gator Nationals Pro Stock semifinal on the line. Left side of your screen, that's Sean Gann. Hector Arana's on the other side.
Hector Arana, your 2009 Full Throttle Champion. As we take a look at the ladder and how they got there, that's the matchup on the line right there. The other one we're going to see is Eddie Krawick up against Craig Treble. Eddie will pretty much run for run right there with Hector Arana. He's definitely got a chance of being able to get the round win and getting in the final here. But Hector Arana, if he's like we saw last year, he's able to step up when he needs to. At least he was in 2009.
First race of the motorcycle season. We've seen an inordinate number of red lights today. And we see one again.
Hector.
Hector, the reigning champion. That's the fourth race in a row that Hector has fouled. It's Sean Gann that is heading into the final. Wow. Go to Gary Gerald. He has Mike Edwards.
Fumble and get the right switch on here. We can talk to Mike Edwards. When you're experiencing such dominance, what do you worry about each time you go to the line?
Well, I don't know if it's dominance. We just, we're having a time of our life. We're out here just, you know, we've been doing this a long time, and we just, we're running really good, you know, and everything's going our way. But it's all because of the Lord. He's blessed us so much. But, you know, I'm getting pretty old, Gary. I have to try extra hard not to to do good, not let this team down. But you know, I'm just real thankful and blessed. Just this team, they just keep amazing me time and time again.
Thanks.
So here is Craig Treble and that man Eddie Krawick. His bike has been terrific this weekend. He's had some career best passes.
Big advantage for Treble.
Treble came ripping off that line, but can he do it?
Wow.
No, he cannot. Come from behind Krawick, a 690, 194 miles an hour. Steve Tartaglia, he's like, wow, how'd that happen?
I didn't think he was going to catch him. I mean, Treble had a huge advantage off of the starting line, over 700ths of a second. You take another look at it. At the stripe, though, it was only 33 ten-thousandths of a second was the margin of victory for Eddie Krawick. One more look. Look how close 33/10,000th of a second is. It is close.
Oh, more importantly, look at those incrementals with Krawick taking it where it counts. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Well, you have to go back to the U.S. Nationals, I think, in 2004, the last time that we saw Sean Gann in a Pro Stock motorcycle final. That's been a long, long time. What's it been like waiting to get back to this opportunity when you're going to go against Eddie Krawick?
I really hadn't had the Buell too long, and Rum Bum was Lewis Bacardi's very awesome guy to come on board with us and sponsor this deal. And it has been a long time, and I got children now and a wife, and life is unbelievably great. And to go to a final here at the first race of the season, my son Ethan and Andrew, I know they're watching, and my wife Jessica, she's watching too. I'm sure that everybody's kicking in Stoneville. That's going to be a live place.
Well, I'm sure it will be exciting. We wish you well. I want to swing over here. The defending champion of the series, of course, is Eddie Krawick. Man, a little late off the line in that last one to get into the finals. Did you have any doubts that you'd be able to chase down Craig Treble?
Well, you really don't know how far out he is. Craig's an awesome racer. He tried putting me over his knee and spanking him, but, you know, and spanking me. But this Screaming Eagle, Vance and Hines, Harley Davidson, V-Rod, going to another final. You know, Matt's doing a great job tuning the bike. Awesome. I got a lot of fans, a lot of support, everybody out here pushing for me. So I got Willie G and Billy in the house. So hopefully I can bring home a Wally for them.
Well, this is a pairing in the finals we haven't heard about in the past. Krawick and Gann.
And in the grandstand.
In the booth, they're coming our way. Get ready.
We'll be back. You think there is history here at the Gator Nationals? Let's show you some.
1983, Frank Holley driving the Chi-Town Hustler with Austin Coyle tuning, wins the Gator Nationals and a second straight championship in a row.
92, this was the day that Kenny Bernstein became the king of speed, the first pass at over 300 miles an hour.
And it all cast, but boy, what an expensive run it was as the body lifts off. Cruz was
coming up. This is the semifinals for Tim Wilkerson as he faced Tony Pedregon and got the win over Pedregon to set him up to face Bob Tasca. John Kernan now has Tim Wilkerson.
Tim Wilkerson getting ready for his final round matchup against Bob Tasca, who is not really a teammate, but there's an affiliation there. So what are you going to teach that young kid in the finals?
Well, I hate to tell you, but he's a young kid, and he's probably got it going on already. I don't need to teach him anything, but happy for Ford Motor Company. Bob and I are really teammates. We share a lot of information together, and, you know, we've really done just happy for Ford Motor Company, for Levi Ranshaup, for Motorcraft Quick Lane, for Summit Racing, all the people that support Bob and both of our cars, really. It's just been a tremendous day, and for a new car debut with a new 2010 Shelby Mustang, one of the Shelby Mustangs is going to be holding up the trophy.
And they are good-looking cars, that's for sure.
The NASCAR Nationwide Series is heading off to Bristol for some short track racing. They're off this weekend, so Kurt Busch was here racing in Super Gas. Michael Waltrip was here. NASCAR Nationwide at Bristol, 2 o'clock on ABC with NASCAR Countdown presented by Hellman's. And so now, Mike Dunn, it's time to take a look at our full throttle, hard-working crew.
And we're going to start out with Pro Stock Motorcycle, Karen Stouffer. A rule change that allowed him to get another 100 cc's, about 6 cubic inches. They only got it, came down about a month ago. Had to work really hard to get the crankshaft. No testing. What are they? Great job by that team. Then how about Vinny DeSigli? He crashed his brand new Avenger in Phoenix. They bring out the qualified in the top half of the field. Then how about Matt Hagen in Funny Car with all the turmoil bringing over John Medlin on Saturday morning to work with Tommy DeLago. They go out there and run the fastest speed ever in the first round, 313 miles per hour. And how about Antoine Brown after losing the tire in the first round in Phoenix in that tragic accident? The team was really down, but they gathered together, came back and made a great run all the way to the final round.
Finals time. Here is Pro Stock Motorcycle. Sean Gann and Eddie Krawick. Eddie is looking to win his sixth career race. Now, coming into this race last season, Eddie had no wins, but he had a championship. Now he's trying to win in his sixth race. Sean Gann last won at Denver in 2004. There's Sean.
Well, based on what you're telling me, you'd want to stack the deck in Eddie Krawick's favor, the 2008 champion. But you got to give Sean Gann some credit. I mean, that bike's been run fairly consistent all day. Eddie has been run slightly quicker. Sean's had some good lights, too. So they match up pretty well. Slight edge to the Harley. But, boy, you can't count out Sean Gann right now.
You'd think that he would have some sort of emotional advantage just because he's here.
No, I think he's been on his game. I mean, he's had, you know, Sean, we're talking about Sean Gann. He's been on his game. He's had some good lights. But, you know, Eddie Krawick's a tough customer. Slight advantage.
Very slight. Let's see where it goes, though. Eddie Krawick.
Wow.
689, 195 miles an hour. Well, Sean Gann loses with a 690.
Laps time.
Dave Reif.
Well, Matt Hines, here we go again. Eddie off to a great start. How good was it this weekend for that Screaming Eagle?
Oh, it was awesome. We didn't do any testing coming here. We just thought we'd start the season off clean with some stuff that we had already worked with, and pick up a win on the first race is awesome. You know, Eddie did a great job.
So the Pro Stock motorcycle season gets underway, and the win by Eddie Krawick, former champion. Now it's time for Pro Stock, and the question continues: can you beat this man? It has been tough. Mike Edwards. Edwards is looking to win his second Wally in the same weekend. To do that, he's going to have to get around Jason Lyne, who's looking for back-to-back wins here at the Gator Nationals.
And, Paul, Jason told me his strategy was to try and run over Edwards in the staging lanes. Well, that didn't work, so now Jason says he's got to do the best job that he can and hope that Edwards beats himself.
That first strategy, I think, was his best.
I'd go with that, yeah.
Well, but, you know, I'll tell you what. I mean, it seems like right now the only way you can beat Mike Edwards is if he beats himself by making a mistake. And he hasn't been doing that at all this entire weekend. So, Jason, all you can do is go up there and just do your job, stay focused, hit the light. Hopefully he has a good setup on the car. You know, if he can get a couple hundreds off on Mike, and Mike's going to have to be a little bit off to do that because he's been consistently in that 030 range. But, you know, if he's off and hits an 040 or 50 a little bit, and then Jason can nail the tree and make a decent run. You never know, but it's going to be tough.
Line last one at Memphis. Both taking their time.
And he did the job on the line.
Now can he carry it through? Jason Lyne does it. That 004 was what was needed. A hole shot win, 658, 210 miles an hour. His teammate Greg Anderson watches from the starting line. Oh, yeah. It's a good day for them and a great day for Ken Black.
Smile pretty much says it all. You know, a number of years ago, your partner there, Jason, was his own worst critic with driving. He just went 004, which gets him out the gate. How much better has that guy's driving become?
I don't know that anybody's doing a better job out here for the last year. Jason's done a fantastic job, and I just feel bad we haven't given much of a horse lately. I haven't had much of one. He hasn't had much of one. We feel a little bit embarrassed. We're not giving Mike a good run for his money on performance, but there you see it right there. They're not decided on the scoreboard sometimes. It's right on the starting line, and he's the man right there. Thank you, Jason. That's a birthday present for me. And Ken Black, hopefully that puts a smile on your face, buddy. Love you.
Oh, wow. Jason Lyne. Big celebration, G-Man.
Hole shot wins in the Gator Nationals. You tell us how good they are, Jason Lyne.
Oh, man, that's best ever to beat Mike Edwards on the hole shot. He's tough right now. It's the only way you can beat the guy. He's just crushing us. He's making us look bad. But this one's for my boss. It's for you, Ken. We love you. And it's been a crazy offseason and a lot of stuff happening. But we're just happy. You know, Ken's on the way to recovery.
By the way, 004 on the tree.
004. We'll take it. Thank you.
And 2 years in a row, back-to-back for Jason Lyne, he beats Mike Edwards on a hole shot.
Right here, Jason.
Well, it is Nitro that's coming up shortly here. Conversations on the line with John Forrest. That's Kurt Busch. He, Michael Waltrip, he's been there. NASCAR has the weekend off. Kurt Busch was even racing here in Super Gas. Let's go to Gary Gerald again.
Well, Eddie Krawick has made his way from the very far end to this point, and a Wally is about to be put in his hands. This is becoming a familiar procedure for you, but man, once again, it looked like you had to chase down Sean Gann. Tell us about it.
Yeah, I really don't know how far out. I don't think I was too bad. I'm just glad that the Screaming Eagle Vance and Hines Harley-Davidson got the win here at the Tire Kingdom Nationals. You know, thanks to everybody out there that supports us. We have a huge, loyal fan base of Harley people. All you guys are the ones that support us and make sure that our program goes up and down that track. Hats off to you. My wife's at home. She's pregnant. We're expecting our baby girl in a couple weeks. So baby needs a new pair of shoes. So hopefully I can get her some now.
Very nice. Stat guy?
Congratulations to Eddie Krawick, the first win of the season. Here's a great stat about Eddie. Think about this. Of all the full-time pro stock motorcycle racers last season, he's the only one not to foul. And in the motorcycle class, that is gigantic.
That's a huge stat. Boy, you dug that one out. That's great.
Yeah.
Eddie Krawick, the pro stock motorcycle winner. But you know what? Nitro is on the line very shortly. Funny Cars will be coming up, followed by Top Fuel. But first, it'll be Wilkerson and Tasca. ESPN's presentation of the Tire Kingdom NHRA Gator Nationals is brought to you by Full Throttle. Feel the energy at work. By Tire Kingdom. Right now, buy three tires and get one free. See store for details. And John Deere. Deere season is going on right now. Visit your John Deere dealer today. That's 16,000 horsepower rumbling on the line. When we go in 2 weeks to Charlotte, it's going to be 32,000 horsepower because we're going four wide. But right now, Funny Car Final. This is a matchup of the Alliance teammates, Tim Wilkerson and Bob Tasca. They work together. They're not willing to call it a team per se, but they do an awful lot of research and development together and share a lot of information.
And Bob Tasca was telling me, Paul, back in the pits getting ready for this, that they'll be okay as long as they can keep the front wheels on the ground. That last run in the semis, they lifted up about 600 feet in. He had to catch it. It was a very wild ride. So far, they're happy with what the clutch is telling them. They had been struggling there. They think there's more out there. They're going to really go for it here and try and back up last year's victory at the Gator Nationals.
Well, and to keep that front end on the ground, sometimes what you have to do in a funny car down track, you can put weight on the front end, but that'll upset the balance of the car launch. And sometimes what you might want to do is maybe just take a little bit of rear wing out of it so it doesn't put that downforce too much on the back and keeps that front end down on the ground so the driver can drive it much better.
Wins by lane as we get ready for this funny car final. It would look like Tim Wilkerson is in the right place.
I think that number's a little deceiving. It's 10-4 in the right lane, but these later...
Bob Tasca, the defending champion, looking for back-to-back wins at one of the majors here at the Gator Nationals. Tim Wilkerson! Tasca came off a little late, but Wilkerson took it all the way through 409-303 as Bob Tasca.
Wilkerson, that's a great job. You know, he ran a 409 in the second round, Tim Wilkerson did, in a couple of 14s and an 18. So I'm sure he said, let's set that thing back the way it ran the 09. The conditions are cool. And guess what? It went right down that racetrack and into the winner's circle.
Let's go to Dave Reif.
Jeff Jacobs, that car front half, the brand new 2010 Ford Mustang body. I know Tim wasn't real excited about having to make such a big change early in the season. How excited are you about it now?
Hey, we're pretty excited. You know, that the back half of that car, we ran in 08, and it was a darn good car, and we just decided to, you know, bring it out and try it again.
You're surprised it all came together so quick.
Yeah, I mean, we got a lot of good data on that car, and that thing is just so friendly. It's just unbelievable, so I think we're going to like it.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
For Tim Wilkerson, his first race win at the Gator Nationals. He last won last year at Sonoma. And that makes him 14th in career wins and ties him with Robert Hyde on the all-time win list. Top Fuel now. Side by side they go, the teammates from Don Schumacher Racing. So the check's going in the Don's pocket no matter what. But who will have their name on the Wally? Will it be Tony Schumacher or Antron Brown? Schumacher looking to win his first race of the season. He last won seven races ago last fall at Dallas.
I remember press release after Phoenix, Schumacher talking about it's been so long since he won a race and seven races. Come on, I went 50 some odd races one time between wins. I mean, DeSarge, he's getting a little bit spoiled, but when you have a race car like he does, it would be easy to get spoiled.
Their fifth final round matchup. They each have won two times prior. The weather here today has been absolutely outstanding for racing. Maybe not Florida sunshine like with 69 degrees and clouds overhead now, but boy, in terms of racing temperatures and humidity, perfect.
Yeah, absolutely, and the track temperature's gone down just a little bit here in the final round, so the conditions should be perfect. Antron with lane choice taking the left-hand lane. They've liked that lane, and I can't see anything wrong with either one of them. Your number one and your number two qualifier here in the final round. It's usually the way you ride it up, but it doesn't usually end up working out that way.
Schumacher gets his first win of the season. A 379, 322 miles an hour. Low ET of the race, quickest run of the weekend.
How about that?
And with that run, Tony Schumacher backs up the speed record. What a day. Fourth Gainesville win for the shoe. And he is now leading the class 62nd win.
A little bit surprised to see tire smoke from either one of these cars. They were both very consistent all day long, but obviously Antron Brown, they were probably going for it a little bit. Couldn't tell if it shook the tires loose or just flat blew the tires off it, but no problem here for Tony Schumacher and that Army team. 282 miles per hour at the eighth mile. They were pouring the coals to it. 379 low ET of the meet. Said, hey, thank you. We did a little engine damage there, but hey, no big deal. We'll replace that and be back for the next race.
We got the money. Dave Reed.
Mike Green punctuated with low elapsed time of the weekend. How good of a race car was that one, in your opinion, this whole weekend?
We had a pretty good car. We were chasing our teammates a little bit. They ran a little quicker than us every run, so we knew we had to do a little extra, but we got lucky. They smoked the tires, but we made a pretty good run, and Tony's just driven great all weekend. You know, he's we've had some guys take shots at us races, but he showed up this weekend, and he just drove awesome.
Team owner Don Schumacher standing right next to me. We'll get with him in just a moment. First, we want to talk to your son at the far end.
Good one.
Well, I know it seems like a long, long time to you since you were here holding a Wally. To other mere mortals, they crave these moments. How tough has it been being denied the last half dozen or so races?
Well, you know, they've been awesome races. You know, I've gotten beat by just, like Mike said, we haven't been outrun this year. You know, it's just been a, we've gotten beat, and we've gotten beat with dead ties. We've gotten beat by great runs, you know, miracle runs in the other lane. That's the way it goes. But for the U.S. Army, it's just too cool. For all the soldiers and guys at Matco Tools, got to be loving this, man. Gates belts, all the people that we love, the families, man, that were built of. It's cool to have Sergeant Major King out here and Colonel Cross, man. These guys come out, they're our buddies, man. They're our buddies, they're our pals, their families back at home. Of all the warriors out there doing our job for us, the United States soldiers and their families, you just can't beat it, man. Awesome win number 62. I got to keep winning, man. Dixon's winning. I got to keep winning. I'm not letting that boy catch me before I retire.
This is going to be some special season. Yeah. Back to Dave Reeves. Yeah.
With a very happy father, Don Schumacher, you were never fortunate enough to be able to win this race, living vicariously now as your son wins his 62nd. But the weekend as a whole, the Top Fuel win. John Medlin going to be a great addition to the Matt Hagen Funny Car team. That was low elapsed time, big speed all weekend long. How was this weekend in the Don's eyes?
It was a fantastic weekend for Tony to pull it off in the final against Antron, who, I mean, he's my brother. You know, I mean, they talk about those kind of things, but I got a special place for Antron. Tony's my son. I do live through what he accomplishes out here. My whole team, all of the funny cars, Craig Treble on the bike, everybody really stepped up this weekend, and I got a fantastic team that works together. John Medlin coming on board is just an exclamation point. He's going to bring fantastic things to this team. He's thrilled. We're all thrilled.
Congratulations, especially after a rough Phoenix.
Thank you much. Say hi to the wife and Stewart.
Why do you call it a super team at Don Schumacher Racing? We've got the numbers to show you exactly why. Through three races, here are the stats.
That is impressive. Out of the six drivers, look at that round record, 32 and 15, only two round one losses and three wins. That team does very, very well.
And we send you back to Gary Gerald.
Well, patiently standing by, and we haven't forgotten about you, Tim Wilkerson. I'm curious. You hadn't won a round of racing in the first two events. Today, you knock everybody to the trailer. What was the difference? What created this turnaround?
Well, I don't know. I think we had some racing luck today. There's no doubt about it. There's plenty of people that could have beat us first round. Only one guy that could have beat us at Phoenix first round, that's who we race. So someday it's your day. Someday you get lucky. And I had a good car when I needed to. You know, Levi Renshaw, Valvoline, Summit Racing, all the people that are behind my Ford Mustang. What a great day for Ford. And Bob Task and I, this is what we've been dreaming about ever since we started iAlliance last year, to be in the finals together. And I'm so happy for Bob. He's just like my own boy. It makes me so excited for him. And I really can't say enough about all of our sponsors. You know, we're in diversified yacht country, too. And so I just cruised into the finals in my diversified yacht.
You talk about cruising. Now, 2 weeks from now at Charlotte, you're going to be going four wide. What's that going to be like? What kind of nerves are you going to have there?
I don't know. I'm gonna deal with that circus when I get there. We're excited about that. I was involved in the first one, and I think as long as everybody stays focused and does a good job, that you're gonna see some great racing. If you're a fan, it's gonna be something you'll never forget, and it'll be a one-in-a-lifetime experience for all of us. But you know, for Bob Task and all of his guys, I think all of us need to be pretty proud about the day, especially my guys. We worked real hard today.
Well done.
Thanks, guys.
Yep, four wide in just 2 weeks. Let's go to John Kernan.
And you know, Paul, you've had a problem in the final eliminations if you're talking to me. Both of these guys did. So, Bob, we'll start first with you. I'd mentioned in the semifinals lifting the front end off the ground. What happened there?
Well, we had a disc that actually broke away, and it welded real hard, and it had the front end way up in the air, and I was wheeling it to try to get it down. And heck, I was hoping it was going to do it again because it went fast. But the guys will go back. It was a good day for Motocraft. Got a Ford in the winner's circle with my teammate, Tim. Force One Pomona. So these Fords are running strong out here.
Thank you, Bob. And Antron, what happened to you out there in the final?
It's just we got a little fast tire shake, it felt like, and we spun them up. I mean, you can't leave nothing out on the table. That U.S. Army team did a phenomenal job this weekend. And you know, our hat's off to them. And we still won as a team. So it's a group effort. And we won. And team, and you felt we're up, but we're on the road to the right track, and we just want to dedicate that race to, you know, Susan Zimmer's family, because his hearts go out to him, because our hearts are still deep for him. And hey, we're headed off to four wide, and we'll give it everything we got.
Thank you, Antron.
Oh, that's right, Mike Dunn. In just 2 weeks, we will be in Charlotte at the Bellagio of drag strips, where they have four lanes. We're going to use all four of them, four wide.
When they did it as an exhibition in the fall, I was excited. When they do it for every single race down that track, my head's going to explode.
Qualifying from Charlotte on Saturday, March 7th at 7. Four wide at Charlotte. Be there, be square.